Isn't it a great day? Hello, fifth graders. I'm Dr. Delosier. We're continuing to read Night of the Spadefoot Toads. I'm so excited to continue reading this. I realize we're almost finished with the book, but I am really wondering if Ben is going to be ready to give his report. And I wonder how he feels about adjusting to making new friends. It seems to me he's found some new friends, but I wonder if he actually realizes that. What do you think? Let's read on and find out what happens. Today, our learning targets are, we will determine the theme of a story from details in the text, including how characters in the story respond to challenges. We will do this by identifying challenges and the characters' traits to help identify the theme. And we will explain how a series of chapters or scenes fits together to provide the overall structure of a particular story. We will do this by identifying how characters' conversations relate to the topic. We will know we've been successful as we have discussions about the theme and the components that cause us to recognize the theme. Let's begin. Chapter 16. Did you know the ice fish in the Antarctic Ocean have their own antifreeze? If they didn't, they'd be ice cubes. And did you know it gets so cold down there that your skin would freeze in only a minute? Ben tries to look interested, but to tell the truth, he's sick of hearing about Ryan's geography report. The bus stops and a few kids get off. Ryan babbles on about Antarctica squaws and Adelaide penguins. Ben is wondering how much longer it will take the bus to reach school when he hears a low chant coming from the back of the bus. Someone laughs. The chant gets louder. Ben can't make out the words, but he can tell that more kids have joined in. He turns around. Frankie Merle is in the back of the bus, leading the boys in the back seats in a dumb, sing-songy chorus. Captain Kidd and Snake Man, Captain Kidd and Snake Man, Captain Kidd and Snake Man. Ryan has finally heard it too. Frankie is such a jerk, he mutters to Ben. Before Ben can stop him, Ryan stands up in the aisle and shouts in the same sing-song way, Frankie's such a jerk! Frankie's such a jerk! He yells even louder than Frankie, and the kids on the front of the bus stop talking and turn around. When the bus slows down for the next stop, Frankie makes his way up the aisle and pushes Ryan back into his seat. Say that again, matey, he says, holding one hand over his eye like a patch. Ben's heart pounds. Stop it, he says. Oh, look, Snake Man can talk. Frankie turns around to make sure the other boys are watching. He makes a rattling sound with his mouth. Leave Ryan alone, says Ben. You started it with that stupid chant. What do you say, Cap'n? Do you want me to leave you alone? Frankie tries to yank Ryan's glasses off, but Ben knocks his hand away. The glasses with the patch hang lopsided halfway down Ryan's nose. Ben has had it. Without thinking, he climbs over Ryan and lifts Frankie up by his jacket, pushing him back down the aisle. How has Ben changed in the story? This weighs his character's character choices and actions imply the theme of the text. If you remember, at the beginning of the story, Ben didn't really want to have anything to do with anyone in his class. He wasn't even trying to make friends. Then he began to want friends, but didn't really do anything to help make friends. He did get along with Mrs. Tibbetts, but he didn't really have any friends. And then later, when I see what Ben is doing now, I believe he has begun to realize that maybe he does have friends. And I'm wondering, do you think he's doing some things, making some choices that show that he is also a friend?
Hey, the bus driver shouts. Enough of that. Everyone in your seats.
Suddenly, everyone is yelling and hooting.
Leave him alone, Ben screams. Leave my friend alone.
Ben's eyes fill with tears, but he doesn't care if anyone sees. He gives Frankie's jacket another shake and shoves him back in his seat. The bus driver pulls the bus to the curb and lurches down the aisle.
You boys settle down or you'll be walking to school for the next month.
Everyone on the bus is quiet now. Ben drops down in the seat next to Frankie. Sorry, he says to the driver.
I'd better not hear another word out of you two.
The bus driver glares at them, then returns to the front. So what's significant about this incident on the bus? I am so impressed with your answers. You have worked on building your comprehension skills. I would agree. Ben says that Ryan is his friend. Also, Ben's actions. Danny is laughing at Ryan's joke is also another change. He's not agreeing with Frankie. Why do you think that is important? And how does that support the theme? Let's go on. As soon as the bus pulls away from the curb, Frankie snorts in disgust. I'm glad I'm moving. This school and all the losers in it like you stink big time. You're moving? Ben can't believe what he just heard. You're leaving? When? This summer, Frankie says. I wish it was tomorrow. Who wants to live in this crappy town anyway? Ben tries to hide a smile. Good luck. What do you mean? Frankie says. I mean, good luck being the new kid in a different school. You'd better hope that wherever you move, the kids there are nicer than you, because you can be a real creep. What are you guys thinking? Let's keep reading. Yeah, Brian is up on his knees, looking over the back of the seat. I hope the overtoad eats you up. Danny Martin chokes back a laugh. Frankie glowers at him, and Danny whirls around to face the front. At the next bus stop, Ben heads back to his seat. One for the overtoad, he says to Ryan. Yeah, one for the overtoad, Ryan gives Ben a huge goofy grin and picks up his backpack. Gotta get off here, but I'll see you tomorrow, he says. We'll have a blast. See you, Ryan. Ben watches out the window as Ryan gets off the bus and heads across the street to his house. Ben is still shaky inside from the encounter with Frankie, but he grins. He can feel people looking at him, but it doesn't bother him at all. Then he remembers his geography report. His stomach rolls over once, then settles into a dull churning. Hey, his father is standing at the door of Ben's room. Agatha is beside him already in her pajamas. Hey, Ben says, placing his arm over the notes and desert pictures scattered on his desk. How's the report? Pretty good, Ben says, hoping that will be enough for his father. Oh, no, guys. Ben's not telling the truth again. What do you think's going to happen? Yeah, I think he's going to be in trouble, too. More so for not telling the truth than for not having the assignment finished. Let's keep reading and find out what happens. His dad plops down on Ben's bed and pulls Agatha onto his lap. Ben cringes. This is not good. Your mom thought maybe we ought to take a look at it and see if we can help you finish it up. No, that's okay, Ben says. I can do it. Actually, I'd like to see it. It's quiet for a couple of seconds. Ben points to the papers on the desk. Here it is. Those look like notes. Can I see what you've written? I haven't really written much yet, Ben mutters. He fumbles for something else to say, knowing the truth is about to come out. To make matters worse, his mom sticks her head in the door. Bedtime, she says. Oh, wow, guys. Do you think mom saved him from being caught with another untruth? Oh, no. What's going to happen? Let's keep reading. Ben's showing dad his report, Agatha says, except he doesn't have it. Ben gives his sister a hard look. Why don't you go jump in a lake, he says. Because I don't want to, Agatha says. You're the one who's in. Agatha, enough. Dad lifts her off his lap and puts her on the floor. Have you written anything, Ben?
Not much.
Ben, you told us you were working on it and we trusted you, his dad says. Have you even started writing? Ben shrugs.
Ooh. Uh-oh, Agatha says. Now Ben's in trouble in a bunch of ways.
Shut up, Agatha. Ben wants to strangle his little sister.
What do you mean a bunch of ways? His mom asks.
Should I tell them? Agatha keeps her eyes on Ben but edges closer to her mother.
No,
Ben says. Okay, says their father. What's happening?
Ben got in a fight and almost got thrown off the bus.
I did not.
Did so. The bus driver says you're not supposed to fight on the bus and you did.
Agatha, Ben yells. So you guys think Agatha's helping Ben out here?
Yeah, I'm kind of wondering about that too. But maybe it really is a help.
Why or why not?
Enough, their father says. Agatha, go with mom.
Agatha sticks her tongue out at Ben as mom drags her out the door.
Ben, what is going on with you?
There's so much going on in his head, Ben doesn't know where to start.
Is this about Mrs. Tibbetts? His dad asks. Is that why you're not doing your work?
No, actually, it is about Mrs. Tibbetts, but it's also about Frankie and Ryan and the Spadefoots and Mrs. Tibbetts' sister-in-law and the man from the National Heritage Program and being new.
His father sits on the bed, holding his head in his hands and staring at the floor.
Sorry, Dad, Ben says.
His father looks up.
What are you going to do about your report? It's Wednesday, and isn't it due on Friday?
I'll finish it tomorrow, Ben says.
Just make sure you get it done. His father stands and comes over to Ben's chair.
Is there anything I can do to help?
Ben shakes his head. I love you, pal, his dad says.
I know, Ben says.
Thanks. It's torture getting through classes the next morning. Every time Ben thinks about the report, his stomach clenches up. While Mrs. Kuchar is writing something on the board, Jenny turns around in her seat.
I heard about the fight, she whispers.
It wasn't a fight, Ben says.
Sure sounded like a fight. I noticed Mr. Loudmouth is pretty quiet this morning.
Ben looks back toward Frankie's desk. Frankie is staring straight at him, but he jerks his head down the moment Ben meets his gaze.
Ben doesn't really care about Frankie. He's got more important things on his mind. The pool in the woods behind Mrs. Tibbetts' house is surely gone by now, but he'll just have to stop worrying about the problem and hope he and Mrs. Tibbetts can convince Mr. Lindsay that there really were Spadefoots in the pool. Now he needs to concentrate on his report. He can get more stuff off the internet, and after school he can go to the town library. He can even ask his mom or dad for help. He could draw a map of the area. Maybe he could pull it off. He feels better. He can do it. Here is your assignment. I would like for you to finish reading chapter 16. You may read from the slideshow, or you can log into ReadyGen and read with the online reader. At the end of the slideshow or chapter 16, there are some questions you will need to answer. Go back in the text and support your answers with text evidence. Don't forget to use complete sentences and to check for capitalization and end marks in your sentences. Fifth graders, you are awesome. You can do this, persevere, and you will see great results. You've got this.